Hello, everyone, and welcome to the 35th Patterson Distinguished Lecture. I'm Hani Mamasani. I'm director of the Transportation Center here at Northwestern, and also the holder of the Patterson Chair in Transportation. And one of the privileges that I have as holder of the Patterson Chair is to introduce our Patterson Distinguished Speaker. This is an annual event, this actually is kind of the culmination of activity of transportation activities here at Northwestern. The Patterson Lecture was established here to honor William Patterson, who was a leader in air transport industry. He was the president and chairman of United Airlines from 1934 until his retirement in 1966. He was a life trustee of Northwestern University and was instrumental in the establishment and strategic leadership of the Northwestern University Transportation Center. So this chair was established this endowment was established to honor him. Again, the Patterson Distinguished Lecture is the highlight of our year, in fact. The Patterson Lecture features a leader in industry, we've in the past, throughout its history, and you have on the program the list of previous Patterson speakers, we have had the privilege of hosting CEOs of very important and significant companies in the transportation sector across the board. And today, I'm delighted to introduce today's speaker, Jeff Silver. Jeff Silver is the co-founder and chief executive officer of Chicago-based Coyote Logistics, one of the most innovative, fast-growing third-party logistics service providers in North America. Under his leadership, Coyote became a UPS subsidiary in 2015. And we are delighted here at Northwestern to have had the support of Coyote Logistics as a leadership member of our Business Advisory Council. And again, over the years, very generous and open contributions from the company in terms of staff time, in terms of resources to help us in some of the executive programs that we run here. Prior to founding Coyote in 2006, Jeff transformed the 3PL industry in the 1980s and 1990s with American Backhaulers, the second largest North American freight brokerage at the time. And I should mention that actually Jeff is the co-founder of Coyote Logistics. The other co-founder, where is Marianne? The other co-founder is Marianne Silver, Jeff's better half, who is the people chief at Coyote Logistics, in charge of very innovative programs in human resources and outreach. So we're delighted to have both of them here today with us. Crain's Chicago Business has named Jeff to its 2015 Who's Who in Chicago Business for the fourth consecutive year. Silver was also recently named to the Supply and Demand Chain Executive 2015 Pros to Know Awards for the third consecutive year. And their company has been recognized every year as one of the best companies to work for in the Chicago area. So we're, again, honored to have him here with us. He serves on our Business Advisory Council for the Transportation Center and also at the MIT School of Engineering Dean's Advisory Council, and is a member of the Economic Club of Chicago. Jeff received his undergraduate degree and MBA from the University of Michigan, and then also received a master's in supply chain and logistics from MIT. And again, we're delighted to have him here today to hear about his views and insights about innovation and the successes of his companies. Jeff?
Thank you. Hi. So it is very interesting for me to be here, and I feel very honored. I'm waiting on another bottle of water, so it's going to be 1 second. I give a lot of tours at Coyote. We have people that come in. We've always had a lot of customers that come in to see us. We've had politicians that come in to try to take credit for all the people that Marianne hires. And of late, we've had about 1,000 UPSers that have come in to see what it is they really bought. So I did a few of those today, and my voice is already starting to fail me a little bit. So it's really interesting for me to be here at Northwestern. My career in this business actually in some ways started right here at the Norris Center when I was here looking for a summer job. As Hani mentioned, I did my undergrad at Michigan, and part of the way through my freshman year at Michigan, I decided I wanted to move to Chicago and get a summer job here. My only summer job before that had been as a camp counselor up in Wisconsin, so I had really no experience doing anything. I went to the Norris Center, and I found this great-looking job, and the job was to scrub yachts at Belmont Harbor. Okay? Well, that seemed like a pretty cool idea. I could be by these yachts, that must be pretty glamorous. And so Michigan, as you may or may not know, gets out a lot earlier than Northwestern, April 28th-ish. So my job started May 1st, scrubbing yachts in Belmont Harbor. It's really cold, scrubbing yachts in Belmont Harbor. And the other thing was that, and this will lead into other things later that I'm going to talk about, but the worst part about that job was not the weather, the cold and the wet. The worst part about the job was the fact that you'd scrub the yacht today, and then you had to go back the next day and scrub it again because it got dirty no matter what. And you never got anywhere. You never did anything, and you never built anything. So I lasted a whopping 2.5 days doing that and left. And I found a new job right away, which was painting houses for this company that was, I don't know if they're still here, called David Hopman and Associates, right here. So there were the campus painter guys with the yellow trailers, and the David Hopman and Associates guys had the Victorian painted lady trailer. So started painting houses, and before you got to paint houses, you had to try to sell jobs for the first couple of weeks. That was really my first sales job, was out doing that, knocking on doors, trying to convince people to let us paint their houses. The greatest thing about painting houses was you could start work very early in the morning as soon as it was light, work all day long, and you got paid by the job. So sorry to all the Bernie fans here, but that's called capitalism. It works really well in a lot of ways. And a day or two of painting a house, the house was painted. And yeah, you might need to paint it again in 4 or 5 or 10 years or whatever, but it's better than scrubbing yachts. So, but I'll get back to why that's relevant in a second. The other thing that's really interesting to me, and something that drives entrepreneurs, there's a lot of different things that drive entrepreneurs, and I'll call one of them a bit of a feeling of inadequacy. And there is nothing unlike that feeling right now that I get when I stand up and I'm invited to deliver this lecture, given the people that have done it before me. I saw Alan Mulally here a couple years ago, given an unbelievable speech. There have been, you know, Mike Eskew, who was the head of UPS, lots of people that everybody knows, some guy from Memphis too, I forget what that guy's name is, some other package company. And all of those guys, to me, feel very out of my league. So really incredible to be invited to do this. But that little feeling of inadequacy also will explain a little bit about the evolution of our industry of freight brokerage. For those of you who don't know or understand what freight brokerage is, or you call it freight brokerage, you could call it transportation brokerage, third-party logistics, non-asset-based third-party logistics. A lot of names to it, but essentially what we're doing is using other people's trucks to move our customers' freight, right? So it's all about phones and computers, at least today it is. And it's about finding ways of driving efficiency for our customer and for finding capacity for them that they need to be able to run their supply chains. I found this business through that little visit to the Norris Center. A guy that when I mentioned the camp counselor job that I had, well, that guy that I was a camp counselor with also was living in Evanston during the summers. Thank you very much. He was a janitor in big buildings, and I was a house painter, and we lived and we paid, I think, $60 a month to sublet in Evanston when your students went away. And we spent two summers doing that. When I got ready to graduate from Michigan, I had no idea what I wanted to do still when I grew up. I was an econ major, which basically got me ready to do nothing. Sorry if there's any of those in here. And there's always a career in logistics, and you can meet Marianne afterwards if you're looking. And so he graduated a year earlier than I did, and he ended up in this little trucking thing called American Backhaulers that had been founded just before that as transportation was deregulated. And the idea was to be able to use, interestingly, private fleets on their backhaul. Right, so these guys had started with a few of these private fleets. Kidd and Company made marshmallows. Singer had, the sewing machine guys also made furniture, and they had a lot of large trucks, right? So trying to load them on their backhauls. Carnation Company, Carnico Transport. It very quickly became apparent that there was not enough available capacity at that point on those private fleets to be able to move any significant amounts of freight. But nevertheless, as I got to Chicago back in 1984 and joined this little thing called American Backhaulers, the industry was really just taking off, and I sort of was a little bit of the right guy in the right place at the right time in some ways, right? So the very first day I got there, they sat me down at a little card table. They gave me a Rolodex of all, like a contact list for the students in here. It's a Rolodex. It was paper that went around and around with people's numbers on it. And it had all the trucking companies that they dealt with, their numbers on there. And we had these slotted load boards with these 3x5 cards on them, one for each load for each day of the week, all the loads that needed to move, and a three-line phone with push buttons and stuff. And they said, call all those carriers, find out where they've got empty trucks, and try to match them against the loads and sell them the loads. And so that was what I did my very first day. They gave me a yellow pad of paper. I wrote down where all the trucks were as fast as I could, because we were this new thing called a broker, and we were calling these carriers that had never heard of a broker before and telling them that we had freight that we would load them, and they're like, what are you talking about? And the fastest thing they wanted to do was get off the phone, right? So they'd spit out five trucks. I got a truck in Chicago, Columbus, Detroit, whatever, and we'd write them down as fast as we could. I wrote them down, I was the only guy doing it, right? And by about week two, I started abbreviating all the cities and states and the type of equipment, and it just was very inefficient. I convinced pretty quickly after that the guy that had started the business, that owned it at that point, to allow me to go buy a computer. Right, because I had some programming classes in college and done an internship in Paris learning how to actually code. And so went and bought one of the first portable computers. It was called a K-Pro. It weighed about 25 pounds. It had a handle on the back of the keyboard, sort of that folded down, right? So you carried it around like a suitcase. And it had two 64K drives on it. And a little black screen and some little green letters. So the first thing that we did was to write this program that would allow us to record where the empty trucks were, and every hour it would spit a list of these of all the available trucks out, sorted by date, by origin, destination, by destination state, by origin state, by destination state, so that when we got new orders from the customers, we could run to that thing and look where the best trucks were. And I spent the days calling these trucking companies and the nights writing software, and that sort of put me in the right spot at the right time for that. I never thought I would be there or in the industry for more than a year. Figured I would go back to Europe or go to law school or do something, and sort of felt bad about what I was doing. And part of that's a little bit of that feeling of inadequacy. And if you go back to the 80s, as freight brokerage was being born, people thought about it as less valuable than actually running a trucking company, and as the service as not being as good. And really, I've spent my entire career since then trying to overcome that idea. So backhaulers grew pretty well. We ended up selling it to C.H. Robinson at the end of 1999. We were about a $300 million company at the time. Robinson was about $2.7 billion, so together $3 billion. I learned a lot during that year. I lasted about a year flying up to Minnesota every week. I don't know why that's a good idea to have a company based in Minnesota, but it's a good company. It felt like a really big company. Of course, now I'm part of a much bigger company than that, but learned a lot, and then I retired. So I had a five-year non-compete. I never thought I would be back in this business again. We have seven kids, so we had plenty of other stuff to do. But part of the way through going to the beach all the time and vacations and coaching and stuff, I started to think about doing something different. Looked at a lot of different industries and could never find anything where you had that same feeling of having painted the house as opposed to scrubbing the boat, right? And could never find anything where I felt that that same opportunity would be there to get big and good. So, not sure though of what I wanted to do. I thought maybe for some weird reason I might think about wanting to be a professor or something. I don't know why anybody would want to do that, but it was a little bit in my mind. So I was like, you know, I'm not going to try a PhD at this point. I should have listened to myself later when I tried that. But started off, you know, with something pretty easy, an MBA, right, and one of these executive programs. We had always laughed at people with MBAs at our first company because none of us had one, right? We didn't know what they were for. Pretty interesting thing. Started off with finance and accounting. That's not that interesting. Some marketing stuff. And as we got into the second semester, I ended up in this class taught up in Michigan by a Turkish guy named Isaac Duenas. And on the very first day of class, he threw up on the board, or on a screen, I guess on the blackboard, this problem and said, imagine you are a manufacturer of whatever it was, widgets or whatever. You're based in North Carolina and you need to ship out 100 truckloads a day. You have five trucking companies that you can choose from. And they each have different capacity limits and different rates to different states. And you have to figure out which loads to give to which carrier. How do you do that? Well, one of the things that we developed at Backhaulers as we got a little bit more mature in our business was this program that Robinson now calls its TMC, which is an outsourced transportation offering where we would take care of all of a customer's freight and we would do their tendering and tracking and all that kind of stuff. And we said that we were optimizing the loads. So we had large customers that were giving us 100 loads and saying, optimize these and give them to the right carriers. And in a way we were, right? So you don't always have to have a real optimal solution to be really good at what you're doing. And back at that time, there really were no capacity constraints, right? All the carriers had plenty of trucks. Was a very different environment. So in that case, what do? You give the load to the cheapest carrier, right? And if you're not in a real hurry, you can sort of go down the list and tender to the first guy and let him take as many as he wants, and then the next guy, and you have a quasi-optimal answer, right? There's nothing really wrong with that, but we weren't really optimizing anything per se. And so Professor Duenas throws up Excel, launches the solver inside of Excel, sets up the problem and solves it in 2 seconds, and I'm like, holy crap, that's really cool. We had always talked about doing it. Here was a way to do it and do it really easily. And loved that class and really started to get more interested in learning more about that and a little less about marketing and all that kind of stuff, and found this program out at MIT and got to spend a year out there. Adding at that point to my feelings of inadequacy was the guy who was the director of that program and a friend of Hani's, whose name is Yossi Sheffi, and he's an Israeli. He's got this pretty heavy accent, although he would deny that. And he always used to call what we do dialing for diesels, right? And it was a little bit of a belittling idea that all we're doing is sitting up and calling trucking companies and finding out where they had trucks and trying to match them with the loads, and there was no science there or anything that would be interesting to MIT in any way, shape, or form. So during the time I was at MIT, I got to spend a fair amount of effort not just learning about the cool stuff that you could solve with what we were learning about there, which is a lot of queuing theory and that kind of stuff, but also started to be able to think about what we could do differently, a little bit about how to overcome that feeling of inadequacy of just being a broker if we were to restart this business again. And so we're doing these network analysis problems, overlaying networks or whatever, and started to get the idea of, could we figure out a way to go back to a little bit of where American backhaulers started with the idea of loading private fleets and dedicated fleets, and to be able to figure out how to create this dense enough network where we're able to take our customers' supply chains, overlay them, and run trucks more efficiently between them. Not us running the trucks, but using their trucks, their private fleets, the dedicated fleets run by people like Schneider and people that do that, right? So the idea started to come at that point for figuring out how to be more than just a broker, right? So made some great contacts there. Some of them help us run Coyote today. Some of them are sitting there. Some of them were at Coyote and are now at Amazon, and it's great to see Bill here. And we got back together for some events and ended up hooking back up. But as I came back to Chicago, I had this goofy idea that again, I wanted to be, maybe learn how to be a professor. So I started a program here in a PhD program in industrial engineering. I lasted, I think, a term and a half. And at that point, we were ready to start Coyote, and Marianne looked at me and said, no more school, and that was it. And the math was really, really, really hard. So, and Chris and Bill weren't there to help me do it. So we decided to start Coyote in April of 2006. The industry at that point looked pretty different in terms of makeup. So Robinson had gone from their $3 billion to $8 billion. In a time when they did not really have a scaled truckload competitor, somebody more than $1 billion, somebody with national scope that could give them a run for their money. There were still 9,000 something small brokers out there competing for all this business, and a lot of the truckload guys had gotten more into brokerage as well. It looked a little bit intimidating. So we knew that we needed to do something a little bit different. And the different that we did was actually pretty simple. So that little feeling of inadequacy again led me to think, okay, how do I get these customers to stop thinking about us as a broker and start thinking about us as a real carrier? And the only way to do that would be to outservice the real carriers. And in a sort of simple way, and having had the good fortune of having enough assets of our own to start, not assets, but money of our own to start the business with, we went into it with the idea that we were gonna do something different. We were gonna actually move every load that we committed to. And this is in an industry where I would say on the average, brokers would show up about 80% of the time for what they committed to, right? So if they could move a load and make money on it, if the truck was close enough to the load, they would move it. And if not, they would roll it to the next day or give it back to the customer or call the customer and say, I need more money. We wanted to try it and see if we could do that differently, right? And we bet on that, and it ties in really to the other thing that we also bet on. And the other thing that we bet on is that culture always wins, right? So our idea was to say, if you go and find the best people you can find and hire them, if you train them like nobody else has ever done, if you arm them with incredible technology, and most importantly, you give them a great work environment, you can win. Now, I'll show you a video right now of what Coyote looks like for those of you that haven't been there, but you will see, and some of them are right up here, that we are full of millennials, right? And I am questioned all the time on what do I think about millennials? Aren't they terrible, right? They don't want to work. They don't want to work hard. They only want to work for themselves. They're not committed. There could be nothing further from the truth, right? I think that the generation of kids that we're hiring today, people coming out of school today, are way more talented than we were. They're harder working than we were. They amaze me. They can do things. They never stop. They are never disconnected from each other. But the one critical thing is they absolutely have to believe in what they're doing. They have got to have a mission that they feel is worthwhile. And we were lucky enough to find those people that would believe in that mission of building a company that was a lot better, of creating service that was a lot better, of people that wanted to win. And all that stuff fit together in a really nice way to create what this looks like a bit today.
Wake up each day knowing that you are part of something special. Something real. Something bold. What you do can make a difference. Be yourself. Be strong. Be smart. Do the right thing every time. We're not only transforming a centuries-old industry, we're also changing people's lives. We're a pack of incredibly hardworking coyotes who want challenges, who want to belong, who want to be part of something that never quits. That's what makes this place magical. Every hour, every minute, every second. No excuses. What does no excuses mean to you?
So what does no excuses mean at Coyote? No excuses means that you do what you say you're going to do no matter what. And we've been that way since the day we started. And I can tell you that we have never given a customer back a load. We do not fail on loads if there is any way possible to get them picked up. At Coyote today, we've grown to the point where we move more than 6,000 loads a day. By the time we sold to UPS, we'd achieved revenue of $2 billion. And that growth was 100% fueled by the idea, by the people that we hired and their commitment to making that happen, and by customers who were willing to say, okay, if you guys make that commitment to us, we're going to commit to you and give you business that's going to help you grow and build that density. So it's been an incredible experience to be part of it. It is humbling to be part of that as well as I watch these young kids and what they do. But one of the things that, really I think has differentiated Coyote as we've gone is the real implementation of that network overlay strategy, where every single day we load hundreds of our customers' loads in each other's trucks, right? And again, they're trucks that they own, or there are trucks that are provided by the Schneiders and Werners and J.B. Hunts, but that are paid for by those customers in dedicated fleet operations, right? It takes a huge amount of freight density to be able to do that, and it takes the right kind of technology to be able to do that, and we've created both of those things in a way that is pretty different. And I know the first question I'm going to get as we turn to Q&A here, so I'm not going to preempt it, but I'm going to tee it up a little bit. One of the things that is really different about Coyote than what we had at our first company is that a huge amount of what we do is for very large customers. We work with a huge number of food and beverage companies, a lot of them that you would certainly recognize their name everywhere, a lot of CPG companies, a lot of grocery chains, and you name it, a lot of big companies. Those can be very challenging to work with and very rewarding to work with at the same time. Their networks are very, very scheduled, right? So if you're delivering to Walmart, for example, or Target or any of those kind of places, you need very set delivery appointments way in advance. And if you miss them, in some cases, you're creating a situation where your customer might be paying a $4,000 fine to those retailers if you miss those appointments, right? And you may guess that what I'm talking about is whether what we do can be Uberized. I heard that question before from somebody, but I'm going to wait till somebody asks it before I address it further than that. But the ability to overlay these networks has given us, again, a different really place in the eyes of our customers, right? Because we become their customers, right? So for many of our large customers, not only are they our customer, we are also their customer. Our ability to load those fleets, to work with these networks, the network overlays, was also one of the key reasons that UPS decided to acquire us, right? So every day, UPS, as it moves packages all over the country, all over the world, but if we talk about the U.S. for right now, there are something like 20,000 empty movements of trailers between different UPS sorts that don't have packages going in those directions, right? So the simple imbalance of package networks, right? And what we have been able to do is to start to load those assets. And now as part of the same company, that becomes easier and easier for us to do. That was one of the things that was attractive about Coyote for UPS, and one of the things that led them to acquire us. And I'll just finish by saying that little feeling of inadequacy, where we were just a truck broker before, was gone well into our existence of being Coyote and receiving awards from many customers all over the place, where we were their carrier of the year, even against some asset-based players. As we developed a new type of what we call our collaborative transportation management platform, where we go in and basically take over part or all of a customer's transportation or supply chain operations types of things. But now, we're in a whole sort of different league. We're no longer like any other little freight broker, because now as part of UPS, every one of the customer interactions that we have has changed, where we can now not just offer our truckload services, but customs, freight forwarding, and everything else all over the planet. So The thing has been great for us. We love being part of UPS, and I'll take any questions anybody's got.
Jeff will. We'll move on to questions. Please, when you ask a question, identify yourself and also make sure that you find somebody with a microphone so everybody can hear you. Mike, we had someone back there.
Howdy. We're asking people to come to us. Yeah. Yep. So.
Hey, Jeff. Bill Seliger, R.R. Donnelly. Always great to hear you speak. You mentioned culture and UPS and Coyote, organizations I know well. They seem like very different cultures. Could you talk a little bit about how that's going and maybe some things you learned that you may not have expected or surprises about integrating cultures of the two organizations?
Sure. So there's a lot of surprises that we've learned about UPS in our first 8 months. It's a lot bigger than I thought it was. I knew it was big. I didn't know, for example, that we operate dedicated fleets. I didn't know we even did that. I didn't know we would be able to reload those dedicated fleets that are actually owned by the same company. Some of them actually dedicated flatbed fleets, which is a very rare type of a beast, right? So, but to the culture question, there's really not very much that is surprising at all. Effectively, we are not integrating the companies in any way, shape, or form. The UPS committed to leaving Coyote and its culture alone. So we have 2,200 employees, 40 to 50 of them are regularly involved with these efforts to load the UPS assets, which we call synergy and not integration, because it's not integrating anything. For the other, 1,150 Coyotes, absolutely nothing has changed in their life. They still go to work in jeans. They're allowed to wear beards. They answer the phone Coyote still, and nothing has changed whatsoever. So I think that UPS has learned a tremendous amount from the acquisitions that they've done. We're a pretty different animal. If you're a package delivery company, I don't care who you are, I think some of our friends in the room are going to experience that as they move forward in Europe and some other places. But if you're running a network and you're trying to, and you buy somebody else that's got another network that are sort of doing the same thing, it makes all the sense in the world to try to integrate those, right? But to integrate what we do into what UPS does doesn't really make any sense whatsoever. We're really good at what we do, and they want us to keep being really good at what we do. So far, that's been great, but really overriding all of that is that I would say two things. The commitment that our Coyotes have to their mission is absolutely the same commitment that the UPSers have to their mission, right? They are the most committed people I've ever seen. They'll do anything to make sure that they execute, right? The other thing is that really a lot of the power of what we created and have created at Coyote is built on the culture and the fact that, and you see some of our Coyotes sitting right there, these people actually love each other. They do. Our culture does not allow anybody to ever stand up and yell at another person. It's not acceptable. From day one, has not been. They are incredibly supportive of each other and everything that they do. They're supportive as we get together to support St. Jude's and raise money for St. Jude's. They all pitch in everything they've got to do that and go out and figure out ways to do that. And they do it together and they do it for each other. And I think a lot of what makes Coyote successful is the fact that they're not working for me. They're working for each other. They're still working for each other now that UPS owns us. And I was mentioning earlier today that we just were at the UPS management conference in Atlanta, the 150 district managers and region managers or whatever they're called, was all together, and you saw that exact same feeling within UPS for each other. It's that commitment to each other and genuine love for each other that you see there. And the idea that you're going to do it the right way every time, no matter what, no matter who's looking. And in that way, the cultures are the same. Yeah, the people might look a little different and dress different, but I think they're in many ways very similar in the things that count.
Hey, Jeff, thanks for being here. Ben Burnham, I'm a student at Kellogg, and was wondering if you could comment a little bit on the truck driver shortage and maybe how the truck driver shortage and how that's impacted your business and maybe how you see that playing out over the next few years.
Well, if it ever really happens, I'll tell you. I don't know. It's it's a great question. It's something that we've been watching a lot and that everybody is predicting is going to happen, and it makes all the sense in the world that it will. If you would have asked me a year and a half ago, I would have said it's going to be here now, and I was dead wrong. Right now, there is a lot of capacity all over the place. That will not last forever. Government regulations will make it worse. Our driver population is continuing to age. What we do is about supply and demand. And as long as there still are drivers in trucks, we will see freight rates move up eventually when things get tighter. And they always, you know, we used to in those days of the 80s when we were sitting there in our first business, we had this sort of cycle where about every quarter it would change and there would be too many trucks or too many loads or too many trucks or too many loads. It doesn't really do that anymore. And it's just really hard to tell because we've been in this no growth economy for so long following a really bad couple of years in 08 and 09 where we get basically nothing here and we're all sort of trying to go along and do what we do. And all of our customers are trying to do more and more with less and less, and trying to you know meet their budgets and do what they're trying to do, that it continues to be something that we watch, and everybody's trying to figure out what happens when the electronic logs go in. You know, all the big carriers, the Schneiders and everybody, they're all completely compliant already. So you know that's not going to be an issue for them. The little guys, it's hard to tell how much of an effect that's going to have. I think one of the things that's the most interesting for us as Coyote is that about half of the capacity on the highway today belongs to those private and dedicated fleets. Even with our efforts, most of the time, those guys, after they deliver, are going back empty, right? So for us, that bodes well in terms of our ability to load those guys. The more sort of constrained the capacity is, we become more valuable in our ability to do that. And we have those 20,000 assets every day that need loads for the return trips that belong to UPS, right? So and every one of those guys is compliant.
Professional engineer. There we go. Barry Kravitz. So on the topic of lazy assets, extra capacity, not enough drivers, it's my understanding that a year ago December, the Amazon folks engaged the U.S. government and the lazy assets at the post office to have deliveries made on weekends, using both their trucks and drivers, etc. So I'm wondering if there's a significant amount of excess capacity in that particular arena, and if that could come into play in your operations and at the same time help out the post office department in providing more cost-effective use of resources.
You mean in terms of doing stuff on Sundays?
Saturdays and Sundays with
It doesn't really happen that way in the over-the-road trucking industry in the same way. You know, we move loads every single Saturday and Sunday, or the carriers move loads for us, and that's a normal part of the business. A lot of shippers are not open on Saturdays and Sundays, right? So there's a lot less that happens on Saturdays, a fair amount less on Saturdays and certainly a lot less on Sundays than that happens during the rest of the week. Now, if all things were equal, and you wanted to use assets the best way, you would level load everything across every day, and you would make sure that everybody's open every day of the week and forget about any rest or religion or whatever else, right? And everybody could work all the time, and you could use the fewest number of assets to do that, right? It would be more efficient. Right, because when you have those peaks in demand, you create the need to build those in to some extent, and you have too many loading docks that you really need, right? More than you really need, because you got to be able to accommodate the church on Easter Sunday kind of thing.
Hi, Scott Sigmund from the Illinois Soybean Association. Motor fuel taxes haven't been raised at the national or at this state's level since the early 90s. How does that affect the non-asset-based 3PLs? And to what extent does it matter with the patchwork of other states that have begun to raise motor fuel taxes and invest in their infrastructure? And is there anything that the non-asset-based 3PLs would do about that?
So I don't think that there is really any direct result whatsoever or direct effect whatsoever on us that I can think of off the top of my head. That will affect sometimes where drivers fuel their trucks, right? But that really is, you know, they're not our trucks in terms of what we're doing as a non-asset-based player, right? So I guess the only thing I could think of possibly would be that with lower taxes, you should be able to have more freight moving because, right, it's less of an impediment to move stuff. I don't really know. It doesn't really affect us, though.
Hi, John Plan. I'm a director at Metra. A quick follow-up on that. The president of the Illinois Senate recently suggested, then immediately retracted, the idea of a vehicle mileage tax. Would that affect the business at all?
I mean, as long as it's applied fairly, all that would do is make it more expensive for you to buy milk or soybean oil, right? That's all going to be passed through the consumer. People will eventually buy less. There'll be less freight moving, and everybody will do less by giving more to the government.
I'm Keith Schoonmaker. I'm a stock analyst with Morningstar and a Kellogg alum. I had a question for you. You move freight for many customers who don't own you. Why was it attractive for UPS to actually buy you to help them coordinate? In other words, how is it better for UPS to have you part of the family rather than just as a good supplier?
So we started working with UPS 4 or 5 years ago by providing some of the excess capacity that they are allowed to procure for peak season outside of their normal labor contracts, right? So every peak, a lot more freight moves, roughly twice as much freight moves. I want to make sure I'm allowed to say that, sorry. Roughly twice as much freight moves or packages move through the network during peak season, right? Which is more or less Thanksgiving to the week after New Year's, right? And so you need trailers, you need drivers and power to be able to move those packages between the sort facilities. And we started a little bit at a time and then a lot more and then a lot more, providing that capacity for UPS that they otherwise went and tried to source on their own in this very ad hoc way, only at this one particular time of year, which is a very difficult thing to do and to do well. And they were using, frankly, several other brokers, and their service levels were not what we were able to do, right? So we came in, we started working with them year over year, growing that business. And we got more and more used to each other, and they saw that we could out-service pretty much anybody that they used and started to rely on us more and more in what we were doing. So that's where we got to know them. When we started getting, so we took a private equity investment from Warburg Pincus, which is a big New York private equity firm. If you don't know about, well, I'm sure you know about them, but I'm literally the only private equity-backed entrepreneur that loves his private equity company because those guys were absolutely wonderful to work with the whole time. But at some point, it was time for them to cash in their investment. So we had the choice of either going public or selling ourselves. I had a strong preference early on for the acquirer to be UPS, and frankly, I started pushing it as I started to get to know different people up the ladder at UPS. And when they began to understand a couple of things, it became more and more interesting for them to buy us. One of those things was the way we do these network overlays, and there is huge synergy in being able to load those assets. There is a lot of benefit to being able to execute peak very well, as I'm sure you know, and we help them do that. And the other thing is that what we do really fills out the UPS suite of logistics offerings, right? So UPS is roughly a $60 billion company, and about $12 billion of that is global logistics, including us and what we do. And UPS before us did not really have a strong offering in truckload. Now, truckload just in North America is a $700 billion business. So there's also the attractiveness of UPS and being able to grow in that type of a situation with a company that was proven, that executed, that had great service, and that was ready to be public. Right, so they weren't buying something that they were going to have to fix up or fix the culture, if you will, or whatever you want to call it, right? And knew that we would continue to grow as we always have, just in what we do. And when you add on top of that the ability to leverage all of those assets that exist, it's a whole different ballgame.
I'm Mark Mitchell from McLeod Software. I was curious, from a standpoint of entrepreneurship and culture, why Chicago? I mean, is there something about Chicago that lends itself to that combination of transportation and technology, and what can the industry, what can the local community, either the tech community or the transportation community, do to help foster that? We have Silicon Valley and all that stuff. Are we the Silicon Valley of transportation technology?
So one of our favorite places on earth is Rancho Santa Fe, California, and we came very close to moving there before we opened this business. Would have been impossible to do this there. So Chicago, to me, the people that we get to hire here, that's why we're here, right? So as a non-asset-based company, we have nothing, but the only asset we have is our people. I mean, our technology enables the people, but without the right people, it's impossible. And as Marianne invented for our industry the idea of going to college campuses, building a recruiting team that spends time on those campuses and hiring directly out of these schools, we in our first company started doing that in Big Ten schools, at Indiana, Michigan State, Michigan, Iowa, Wisconsin. The Big Ten schools, at least before they decided to go to New Jersey and Pennsylvania and all these places, were great places for us to find employees. So a lot of these are kids that have gone to these schools that may be from Michigan or maybe from Wisconsin, Indiana, Ohio, places where the jobs are not there anymore that were there for their parents. They all want to come to Chicago, and they want to work hard, and they want to play hard, and they want to be part of something. And they're able to come in for these interviews, these day-long interviews, and see what we're doing and see the culture and see that people in there are winning. We hire a huge number of athletes. Not everybody we hire is an athlete, but we have something like 80 guys that played, men and women actually, that played D1 hockey. We have a lot of basketball players and everything, right? So they come into this culture and they want to be part of it. And they want to move to Chicago, just like I did. Right? It's where everything's happening. So I don't think that the community here needs to do anything differently except be in Chicago, right? If they can, if the Cubs can continue to lose, then I'll be happy. So, and if the Hawks could win, I'd be even happier.
Hi, my name My name's Adam Lemazny. I'm with a group called Supply Chain Innovation Network of Chicago, and I love the last gentleman's question about the Chicago community. And I was wondering if you can talk about, you know, from your perspective, being a very technology-based company here in Chicago, and you guys do, you know, your product very well, but how do you stay competitive with changing technology, and particularly looking at all the different 3PLs that are here in Chicago? I mean, what's that community like from your perspective?
You mean in terms of hiring the talent, or how do we keep
attracting? Yes, attracting the talent and keeping your products as advanced, as competitive, particularly with all kinds of different startups and tech incubators that are here, particularly related to transportation.
It's not easy, I'll tell you that. It is not the same as hiring the brokers that we hire, the kids that come in to be brokers. I will tell you that one of the things that I think has really helped us succeed with our technology, there was a time at which I designed myself all of the screens that we use. I don't have to do that anymore. Part of the reason I don't do that anymore is that I think, save one, every single one of our business analysts, BAs, and our quality analysts, our QAs, every one of them came to Coyote to come in and learn how to be a freight broker, right? They came into our normal training program, right? And they worked on the floor, they worked doing what we do for a couple of years, and then expressed an interest in going into IT. And that makes a huge difference in our ability to crank out great software in a way that it answers the problems and the questions that our customers have and that our employees have and our carriers have. Because these are people that are in the middle of the business. It also keeps us from having to go hire those people from the outside. And if the BAs and the QAs get it right, it's a lot easier to have people that can crank code. And they don't all, frankly, even have to be in Chicago. They can be in other parts of the world if you're doing the right job at defining the requirements the right way. So that's a lot of what we do.
Hi, Jeff. This is Scott Hurley with HERE, the mapping and location traffic company based here in Chicago. So I think all day about how maps and location affects industries like yours. So I tend to probably overestimate the impact of it. But I'm curious to what extent your use of maps and location technology, or how you've been able to differentiate with that technology, has been impactful for your success or not, and what you think future holds for the use of that type of technology.
So, boy, I really have no idea. You know, there are technology changes so fast. We have all sorts of mapping applications in our internal software and in the software that the systems that we expose to our customers, nothing like the technology in the UPS package cars that help them adjust to be able to deliver the packages the way they need to, right? What we have found has just been astounding to me is that when we started Coyote in 2006, I thought that we were going to have a lot of the same technology challenges, not a technology challenge, but sort of waste of labor challenges that we always had in the early days and in American backhaulers. And two of those sort of wasted labor things are trying to track drivers by calling them, right? And we had, I don't know, gobs of man hours spent with people on the phone calling truck drivers. We also spent huge amounts of time, energy, and money trying to chase down paperwork, bills of lading that had to, in the beginning, be sent by the driver after he delivered, dropped at a truck stop, or brought back after he finished 2 weeks of running around the country to his dispatch, who would then photocopy it, mail it to us, we would photocopy it, mail a copy to the customer, they would eventually pay us whatever. I think a lot of it was really a ruse by the customers to not pay us for very long, but all of this wasted time really has gone away with the simple invention that we didn't know was going to exist when we started Coyote, and that was the smartphone, right? So the, I know I'm not directly answering your question the right way, but when I think about mapping, I immediately go to that smartphone. And so we have our Coyote Go app, for example, that allows us, if the driver is willing to be tracked, allows us to track that phone with the GPS, and we know where they are all the time. So for example, the carriers, the drivers that are moving these loads for us during UPS peak, you know, they're very hot loads. They always require two drivers on them, and we make sure that we will use drivers that will allow us to track them. We get both of their numbers for their smartphones, and we can see where they are all the time. We don't have to make a phone call, right? And the drivers don't have to get bothered as they're trying to drive down the road in the middle of the night, right? And we have perfect information basically at that point. And when they deliver, they can take a picture of the bill of lading, and we have it already available right then for the customer to see. So that's been one of these really quick little things. Obviously, it affected all of our lives, but it's one of those things that's really different from what we thought we would have at Coyote when we started.
Thanks. Matt Young, I'm an equity analyst at Morningstar here in Chicago. Just wondering from a big picture perspective, if you have any thoughts on XPO Logistics foray into owning assets. Speaking of their purchase of Conway, the LTL carrier, normally you see some of the truckers get into highway brokerage, Knight Transportation, J.B. Hunt, but you don't usually see the brokers get into owning assets. So wondering if you have any thoughts on kind of how that works out.
I mean, I do have thoughts, but I will not comment on that at all. Sorry.
Would you say, though, can you see a reason why a third-party logistics company or as a domestic truck broker would want to own, get into owning assets or controlling a truck?
Guess what? You're looking at them. We have more assets than anybody on the planet now.
You do now, yes.
So if somebody else wants to try to compete with that, go ahead.
Could you comment? You did mention some of you had some thoughts on the Uberization, so to speak, of the industry. And
I was waiting. It took a lot of questions.
I can't let you go on that one.
So yeah, I'll talk about that for a few minutes. I love Uber. Let me start that way. I use it all the time. I use it for specific reasons, and I don't use it for other reasons. I love if I'm in New York City, in Manhattan, and it's 4:30 in the afternoon, and it's raining. Right? And I know I can click that I agree to 4.5 times the normal charge, and I will get a nice black car that will show up and pick me up. I also know that contrary to the yellow and checker cabs, and I know this is going to be online somewhere, I'm never going to get a cab again in New York, but I don't want one, right? Contrary to what those guys do, when I get in that black car, my legs are not going to jam up against the thing that's way back there, the barrier or whatever, the guy's seat, which makes it impossible. I know that when I say I need to go to Lexington Avenue, whatever address, the Uber driver's gonna know where it is. And for some reason, the yellow cab guys always pretend they've never heard of Lexington Avenue. And that's if they speak English at all, right? So, it's always an unpleasant experience. With Uber Black, at least, and I'll differentiate, I love Uber Black. Now, just this week, we've had a lot of visitors again, different customers and stuff in Chicago. I live way north of here up in Lake Bluff, so we're about halfway between our office and where we live, where we're standing right now, 35 miles away roughly from office to house. If I'm going out to dinner with customers downtown in Chicago, I can decide, I don't know if you've seen our building, you saw pictures of it, it's right off the highway there in the city. I can decide at 5:15 that I want an Uber at 5:20 20, and one will be there, right? I don't think I've ever waited more than 7 or 8 minutes for an Uber at our office building. However, when I have been at dinner with the customer, and I know that I want to get picked up at 7:30 or 10:30 after dinner and driven to my house, the last thing I want to do is take an Uber. I want that car service that I know very well, I know is going to sit there and wait for me without charging me for it for a certain period of time at least, and frankly, that knows how to get to my house if I might have had too much Cabernet or something, and could tuck me in bed if I needed to, because he's done it 100. Not, he's never tucked me in bed, but he knows where I live. Right? So there are great possibilities, I would say, for the Uberization of some freight, but not very much. Right? So the other day, our son, who is a freshman in high school, all of a sudden found out that he was going to be pitching on the varsity that evening. So I decided at the last minute that I wanted to go watch him. Right? So I actually saved it on here. I could have projected it, but the Uber cost me, because I took an Uber, my normal guy wasn't planned. It cost me $132 to go from the city up to Lake Forest, okay? That same trip in a pre-scheduled car cost me $65. Why is that? Because that same normal guy always runs those routes. He has some density that he's built in there. Right, he can pre-schedule it, he knows we're a certain kind of customer, and that's what he charges us all the time. Uber has no density coming back from Lake Forest to Chicago. Okay, so let's talk about truckload transportation. Most of it doesn't happen in a dense urban area. Some does, okay, but most of it is moving stuff a longer distance than that. At least that 35 miles from Chicago to Lake Forest, and usually a lot longer than that, right? So the very reason we exist as Coyote is because of that displacement of where the drivers are, where the trucks are, and where the freight is, right? So it becomes cost ineffective to try to pay a round trip every time, because that's what you would be doing if you were Ubering for a truck driver. That's the first thing. The second thing I alluded to before, something like 85% of the loads we move require appointments on both ends or drop trailers, okay? Do you think an Uber situation is gonna work like that? Will a limo guy drop a limo at your house so you can get in it when you're ready and he'll come pick you up? I'm not saying it can't happen. I can't imagine how it can, okay? The next, right, so the problem is, and I was talking to this very, very large consumer products company that was in to see us on Monday, and I asked them the question because I knew we were going to be talking about it tonight at some point. And I said, would you ever just all of a sudden decide that you want this load of whatever products it is to be picked up at some point? You don't care when the guy shows up, and you don't really care who the guy is when he shows up. You don't care if he's really got, right? The qualification to be an Uber driver, as far as I know, and I know I'm not an expert, you can't have any DUIs and a couple of other things like that, right? There's not the training that's involved every time Schneider hires a driver. There's not the investment in the truck. There's not the investment in the four times as many trailers as trucks as you need or something like that. I don't know if you know what the number is, higher than that, whatever, right? So it's a whole different thing. It's different licensing, it's different capital investment. Where I think it can work is in non-CDL type of parcels that are moving around, right? Where it can go in a smaller box truck or something like that. There's LTL moving around in dense urban area or dense freight areas at least. I think you could do some of that with customers that don't care when you pick it up and don't necessarily care when it gets delivered in a way that's pre-planned.
Jeff, I have a question. You've been traveling a lot these days and abroad and then visiting different customers and so on. And one of the key elements in your and your success here, as you mentioned, for Coyote, has been culture, the culture that you've created. To what extent do you think this model is transferable to other environments, other countries?
So I think it's very transferable. It is certainly transferable to Europe. It exists there already, not as part of Coyote at this point, but it does exist there. There are people doing that there. It's different a bit, right? And there's a lot more of what moves in Europe that is really done by distribution companies that route a lot more of the freight, which, you know, if we ever go there as part of UPS, we obviously have a lot of strength in that. It's a little harder just to be that broker again over there, but there are a lot of them and some of them are successful. Certainly, so what you need to have an environment work like this is you need a lot of different customers and you'll need a lot of different carriers, right? And you need to have these market things, you know, that sort of dislocate the freight and the trucks and everything so that you can build this model, or it doesn't work, you don't need it, right? So, you know, for example, there in Newfoundland or whatever, there are seven trucking companies that basically control everything that comes out of there. The model really is difficult in that kind of a situation, right? There clearly are areas where there's a lot of opportunity. Brazil, for example, there is a huge fragmentation in the carrier market. There is a ton of freight that needs to move around, but there are a lot of other barriers that make it difficult. Certainly the people work hard. I've been to different logistics operations down there, and you walk in there and there's very little difference in how they look versus how our office looks. They're in jeans and they're hopping, right? The problems are in areas like taxation, where the government has the right to go back and change the taxes you were supposed to pay 7 years ago and you have to pay it, right? The fact that there are different tax rates for each state that you might drive through as a carrier. And I know of companies that are trying to do this now in Brazil. I'm sure somebody will be successful at it. Certainly, I would think in parts of the Middle East, it's gonna be possible to do it. North Africa, maybe, in some places. Hopefully, as things settle down over there a bit. So,
John Condon from Market Express. Wanted to get your take on the Food Safety Modernization Act and the impact that it could have for Coyote and other brokers. And asset-based trucking companies as well. Similar to Coyote, a large percentage of our brokerage business is food and beverage centric, and we're starting to get some pushback from clients as to what we're doing to maintain sanitary transport of their products. And this is kind of a newer thing for us, and we're kind of in the discovery phase, but interested in hearing your take.
So I guess I am pretty squarely on the side of, you know, we already, since we've been hauling for a lot of these companies for so long, our system allows us to be very specific about what carriers can haul what loads, right? And it can be who's licensed to haul this type of product or not, certain hazmat that you may or may not want in a truck. You know, who can keep ice cream at minus 10, right? This is just another one of those things, as far as I'm concerned, that we'll be able to manage through our system. We know which carriers will be compliant, and you know, eventually what I think it does is it will naturally drive up the cost of refrigerated transportation and drive up the cost of your, you know, quart of ice cream in the grocery store. It's gonna get passed through to those costs from the carriers through us to the customers. It's just like anything else that the government wants to do to us.
Better make it
good.
Make it a good one, yeah, right. I'm Lawrence Audenard from the MITRE Corporation. I wanted to ask you a little bit in terms of a futurist perspective. In my own thinking, I want to ask you, what do you think about the idea of automation and Google Google Car and how that could affect your business going down the road. Clearly, you've gotten here by being very innovative and thinking futuristically back years ago. And so I'm inspired by asking the automated question. Maybe that's not what you're worried about or thinking about is the new technology or the new issues that are moving forward. But if it isn't, I'm curious what you think about automation in trucking or whatever else may be on the horizon. Thank you.
So Hadi and I were having this discussion before a little bit. I think in most ways automation is wonderful and it's coming for sure. To think that any of us 15 years from now are gonna be driving our own cars around, or maybe 20, I don't know exactly how many years, almost seems absurd, right? Where you could call your Tesla to come and pick you up here right now if you want, it can do it, right? There's gonna be bumps and bruises on the way and people that hate the idea, I'm sure the insurance guys aren't gonna be happy about not having humans drive cars anymore. Right, because they're gonna, what are they gonna do? They're not gonna have to sell policies anymore, get to, right? So, I would frankly rather have a really good robot driving the car than somebody who is driving down the road, texting, putting on their mascara, and trying to eat breakfast at the same time, right? And I know the guys that run trucking companies would rather have that than that driver that's doing that and pulling out in front of their truck. I think that the progress is hard to understand how fast that's gonna come, but there is no doubt, and UPS invests in all sorts of different technology companies. One that I saw a week or two ago in California that is developing technology to allow for truck platooning that reduces the drag on really on the first truck, right? I know that there have been tests in Europe recently where they had three of these things or four of them in a row platooning. It's hard to imagine that 20 years from now we'll be driving cars or trucks, right? So the same is true for, you disagree? Okay. Oh, sorry. No, I thought you were shaking your head. The other guy's crazy. So I think other automation is for sure happening too, right? I think the automation inside of plants is going to continue. The use of unmanned aerial vehicles is something that UPS invests in, right? To be able to take a package car driving down sort of a country road that can stop, and the guy can run out and deliver a package to somebody's house if it's right off of the road. But if it's a mile and a half down, you can send one of these little guys down that will drop it on a landing spot on somebody's yard, right? So people are inventing all of that stuff today. And as you think about what's gonna go on inside of warehouses and places where people are loading trucks and everything, the Kiva robots that are now part of Amazon, renamed, I forget to what bill, but there you go. So all of that's happening. I think that the more interesting question for everybody to think about from a futuristic view is what does that mean for society when all the jobs that all the people are doing right now don't exist anymore, right? What is everybody gonna do? So I think that the march of automation is coming. Right, it's going to, I guess, save a lot of people a lot of money, but there are a lot of deep questions that come with that in terms of what our society is going to deal with.
Okay, thank you very much. Jeff, please join me in thanking Jeff for a inspiring and most engaging 35th Distinguished Patterson Lecture. Thank you very much.